And you know, sometimes, I don't know if you're a Facebook person, social media guy, you know, every once in a while on Facebook, you'll say like 7 years ago, this wasn't one of those things. It wasn't like, Facebook didn't remind me about this post I made. Somebody randomly commented on a post that I made 7 years ago. I was like, at first it was like, kind of weird. Like, it seemed like they were all my Facebook posts. Like, you know, what's happening? But then God began to point out that it was a divine moment that he had for me, reminding me of a message that he spoke to me, and that he would like to renew in me and in us. And I could get all fancy, talk about 7 years and all the symbolism and all the kind of cool things like that. That just came to me. I'm like, God is good. This message is for us this morning as a church, as a body, and I hope that you're ready to receive all that God has for us this morning. There's a concept called integrity. You guys are kind of maybe familiar with that, but it says that kind of the basic idea is that it's hard, or we should be able to accept new information, especially when it challenges us, right? In life, we have our paradigms, the things that we live by, and the ways that we've learned, maybe our upbringing or whatever, in the case, we build our life and what we believe and how we're going forward. And every once in a while, we get challenged with new information. Anybody learn anything new? My goal in life is to be a lifelong learner. I always want to be learning, but even sometimes I have a hard time with this concept of saying, okay, there's a new thing and it challenges what I currently believe in, and so that new thing I have a hard time adapting it. But why is it intellectual integrity? Right? If it was if I was truly intellectual, if I were to have true intellectual integrity, then I would be able to say, okay, this new concept I'm willing to adapt, I'm willing to take on, even if it challenges the core of what I believe. I believe today, as we talk, God is going to build in us and challenge us, hopefully challenge us and encourage us in a new paradigm, a new concept, or maybe a renewed concept in us, to remind us of a truth that we once knew and once held dear to, and say, yes, God, I want it, I need it, do it in me. And so that's what I'm hoping to happen today. When I was in college, a lot of times we talked about paradigms. Right, how we see the world, how our life is put together, and maybe the best way that I could describe it would be like a puzzle, right? We got a puzzle, and we put all the pieces together, maybe our experiences, maybe things we've taught, like I said, and we can look at it. But what happens in our spiritual life when we get this paradigm, we have this, what we thought about Jesus, about how we've walked, we've seen things, we've experienced things, we've been to certain churches and have a certain background, and we have this beautiful picture of what Jesus looks like. And then God says, wait a minute, you forgot this piece. No. Sometimes, if I'm honest, when that happens, God says, oh yeah, you remember this thing? Or remember this truth about me? I usually tend to say, well, I kind of like how I have it right now. Like, this looks pretty good. I got it in order. I mean, don't interrupt how I'm like, I paid my whole life on this. Right? But in that, I show my lack of intellectual integrity, my ability to adapt to what God's truth. And I'm not saying everything in life that we have to say, okay, I'm going to bring all this in and adapt to it. But in truth, in God, there's things that he wants to bring into our lives that hopefully, my prayer is this morning, that it creates a paradigm shift and that it allows us to shift. And when we shift, we'll be able to be in order of what God's trying to speak to us, the view that he's trying to give of himself. And today, we get to decision. You know, when he brings things to us, we get to decide, are we in, are we out? We're going to accept it, or are we not? God doesn't like the middle ground, right? We read that in Revelations. Hot or cold, if you're in the middle, he spews you out. So this morning, my challenge to you is, hey, let's be all in on the things that God's going to show us in this message and throughout this year. I was just talking yesterday with Tammy. We got to meet, got some coffee, and I said, I'm excited about this year because I know God is up to something. Like, it's just, like, moving, there's momentum, that God is building faith in us, God is challenging us in different ways. We just did a week of prayer, we're going to do some prayer leading into Easter. We're like, God, we just want you. And I hope that's our same cry that comes from our heart. God, I just want you. So let's look here at first scripture this morning is in Judges chapter 16, verse 20. Judges chapter 16, verse 20. And this is the verse found in the middle of the story of Samson. Samson was a man of God, a man dedicated to God, and the hand of God was upon him. And there were certain things in his life that he needed to follow. And as he followed these commands that God had given him, this decree, this commitment that he made to God, as he followed it, as long as he was obedient and committed to it, God was with them, and he did mighty things for God, and did God's hand of favor on them. And one of these things was that he was never to cut his hair. That as long as he had the long hair, that he had, if our kids were in here, supernatural power. Because like he was able to do feats of glory on God's behalf because of the power, the strength that he had, as long as he didn't cut his hair. Well, then, you know, maybe we have some different people in the room that maybe can associate with this. You fall in love with the wrong person, you flirt with the wrong thing, and he finds himself compromising. Right in the middle of this, and he's gone down this road of compromise, and we find this verse, Judges chapter 16, verse 20. So let's read it. Judges 16, 20 says this. Then she, this is the girl that he was with that really he shouldn't have been with, and he knew he shouldn't have been with, and he was already down that road. Then she, called Samson, the Philistines are upon you. And kind of I just briefly told it, if you're not really familiar with the story, many the Philistines were the enemy of God's people. Many times that was how the stories went around. And every time the Philistines would come upon him, he had enough strength to overpower them. So this is what happened. He said, Samson, the Philistines are upon you. He woke up from his sleep and thought, I'll go out just as before and shake myself free. But he did not know the Lord had left him. So I don't often title my sermons, but today I get to title the sermon. It is this, Beta Version Christianity. And I'll talk about the thought for the day or the idea that I hope that is portrayed and hope that you receive. Is it possible that the Spirit has left and we don't even know the difference? Is it possible there is more to God, but we've been satisfied where we're at? So I know I have some programmers in here, and I don't know the best word to use, if it's beta version, if it's alphaware, or if it's trialware, but you get the picture, right? The beta version is not fully functional, right? It's like a sample. Some of you guys that play video games, they'll send out a beta version of the video game, and it like has, you just repeat the same thing, and it says, wait until the full version, or maybe you have a game on your phone, and it says, if you pay $3.99, you can unlock this secret, or, you know, those kind of things, right? I hate betaware. I hate that function. When I was in college, I adapted to Macs, Apple computers, and so there's a lot of programs that my colleagues were using to study the Bible that were only written in like for Windows and PCs and that nature. And so Logos is a really popular Bible study software. And so my mother-in-law one Christmas said, hey, I'm going to buy you the Logos for your Apple computer. And I was like really excited about this. I'll be able to do all these different functions I heard my friends talk about. I got it. She paid some money for it. I loaded it on the computer. And I found out it was beta version. It was like a trial version. It was like a fake version of the real thing. And it was like so upsetting for me. Like I couldn't do any of the studies, all of the Greek wording and all that good cool stuff. You can like, it wasn't there. And I thought, man, that's really disappointing. But we're talking about this, and we talk about Christ and our walk with Christ and our love for Christ. And I don't want to settle. I don't want to be satisfied with beta. I don't want to be satisfied with half the functions. I want to live and move in what God has promised and not just what I've experienced. Yeah. And I'm praying as a church that we enter into that same kind of season in our heart. And I don't want to just be satisfied with what I got, because when I read this word, I see there's so much more. Sometimes we've experienced a piece of God, not all of God, but we've been satisfied with just a piece. So we're going to, again, like I said, we're going to connect the dots. We're going to play a little connect the dots today, draw a little circle, and I'm going to go over some scriptures briefly. I'm praying that you will write these down or memorize these or get these in you so that you can go back. This is going to be like grounds for coffee. Right, if somebody gave you coffee and you put some water in it, it would dilute it, it would be nasty. But if I give you grounds and then you guys can go home and you can stew on this and you can percolate all through the day or you can chew on it, you know, and then you get the real good stuff. So we're still going to listen to this now. We're going to go through this, connect the dots, and let's start. So we're going to start in Matthew chapter 10, verses 7 through 8. And if you are fast enough, you can, you know, turn through these. If not, I'm gonna summarize some of these. We're gonna just go through this. So Matthew chapter 10 is gonna begin this journey to see God. What is God speaking to Pastor? What did God speak to Pastor 10 years ago? And what is God wanting to speak to us today? It starts here in this Matthew chapter 10. I realize there's more to this paradigm. There's more to this experience. There's more to this walk with God. So Matthew chapter 10, we're going to look in verse 7 and 8. And this is Jesus. Jesus had just spent time teaching and demonstrating his disciples, and then he's about to send his disciples out. And Matthew chapter 10, verse 7 and 8, this is what it says. Go, or as you go, proclaim this message. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. This is the model Jesus sets up for his disciples. It's a model of discipleship. It's a model of training. It's something that we as a church want to continue in. And when we talk about making disciples, this is kind of like the paradigm. This is the lens that we look through. See, Jesus in chapters 4, 5, and 6 of Matthew, he taught. He taught the ways of the kingdom. He taught what it would look like. He gave parables and stories. In chapters 6, 7, and 8 of Matthew, Jesus demonstrates it. He goes out. He's healing the sick. He's restoring things. He's showing them what the kingdom looks like. And then in chapter 10, we see he says, go and replicate. Go and replicate the same power he just said. So there we have a formula, right? We teach. So Sunday morning, we gather together. You get to hear the word. Then we get to, like Jesus did, we demonstrate, chapter 6, 7, and 8. We go out, and I'm glad you guys don't spend 24-7 right here in this room. I would love it. I love you guys. You guys are family. But I'm glad that we go about our life, and the purpose is to demonstrate, to act in the power and replicate that. So then we give that to others, and they do it. And they do it. Powerful. Is what it, so we see here this moment in Scripture. We see... I see three different generations, right? We've got the first generation of the disciples. They got to teach, they got to hear Jesus teach it, they got to see the demonstration, and they got to do it right away. They were out there going out, praying for people, seeing people saved, seeing people healed, seeing God's kingdom come, right? Restoration happened. Then we got second generation people. You know, it's the people that write about it. And today maybe it's the person that made the Facebook post. I was here, I saw this, it was amazing. Put it in Instagram, right? Hashtag awesome. Right? That's the second generation. They get the direct observation. Then sometimes what I see in my life sometimes, the third generation, we simply hear about it. So I read the Bible sometimes, and I read it and I say, wow, I'm just hearing about it. I'm just thinking about it. That's just something that happened. I don't know about you, but I'm tired of being in that third generation category. I'm tired. I know he has the power to do these things. I know there's power in the Spirit. I know that this is possible. I read it. I'm convinced of it. But I'm tired of not seeing it. I'm tired of living with stuff in my life, and I haven't quite fully gotten freedom from it, when I know that the Word of God says that His Word is given to me so that I may have freedom.
Yeah.
But I'm just hearing about stories of other churches or other people seeing God moving. I want this. I want to experience
Amen.
The fullness of God, and I hope you would say the same in your heart. Yes. I mean, I want us going to Target and Hy-Vee and Woodman's, looking at the person in the wheelchair and telling them, get up. I mean, that's what's been passed down to us. We experience the freedom that God has. I love hearing about deliverance stories. I love hearing people say, man, I got radically saved, I got baptized, my life is different, God has given me so much freedom, I'm a different person. I love hearing it. I want some of that. I mean, I don't know about you, but in my life, I've been fortunate enough to see when I laid hands on a man in the middle of Africa and his legs were numb and all of a sudden feeling came back to his legs and his eyesight returned. Like, I've seen that, but it's only been, I could tell you the stories, but it's not a regular, I want it to be a regular, he said, go do it. As you go, preach the kingdom.
Yeah.
I mean, sometimes we get, sometimes the church as a whole, maybe universal, this is a broad stroke, but sometimes the whole, we get upset about this generation and maybe their desire to experience things. I love talking with my brother about his coffee shop because he's always talking about the customers and he wants to have a great experience for the customers, right? And so they come in, the whole thing, the way he's designed everything, the way he presents them, the way they treat the customer, it's all about the experience. And I love it. Sometimes we as a church, we get mad. We're like, oh, I just want experience. Let's teach them something. We got a list of commands and things like that. We have, what greater experience than the power of God? Walk into somebody and say, boom, here's the power of God. Here's the gospel. Here it is. But we're too busy sometimes explaining things to them. Jesus said, go, preach, and demonstrate the power. Let's follow the connect the dots. Let's get a little bit further. Let's get some more ground so we can make some really strong coffee for us to drink all week long. All right, Matthew chapter 28, verse 18. Jesus declares to them, this is something we're familiar with. We love discipleship, making disciples. That's who we are as a church. I mean, if we talk about we're a family of servant missionaries, our whole vision, the whole church is based on this right here. Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. But before all that, in verse 18, is the power that's been given to us. Jesus says, all authority has been given to me. Therefore, go. What is he saying in that statement? He says, I have all authority, and guess what? I'm giving it all to you.
Yep.
We have that. So when we look at Jesus and we read the stories about who he is and what he did and how he walked the earth, we don't just have to say, man, I wish I was there. I wish I could have seen that. I wish I could have touched his cloak. I wish I could have walked with him. I wish I could have been at the, because if I was, I could have, everything would have been different. No, he said, the same authority that Jesus walked in for us. He said, well, no, I wasn't there. I wasn't the disciples he gave it to. But no, what did he tell the disciples to? To go preach the kingdom, to demonstrate it, to give it. We're in this room because over 2,000 years ago, disciples said, yeah, I can do it. I can do the same thing Jesus did. I have that authority. After he raised from the dead, yeah, I want to go. And they received power. We're going to go there next. Acts chapter 1. What is this power all about? Why are we love the Holy Spirit? Why are we excited about when the Holy Spirit fills us and we begin to speak in tongues? Let's look at this. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. It says this. When the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you receive power to be my witnesses. Now, this isn't charisma. Well, I love the fact that this morning we had the kids dancing and stuff like that, but that's not the power that is talking about here. Here, the power is a dynamite power to change everything around us. That's the kind of power God's given us. That's the kind of power we have because the Holy Spirit now resides inside of us. Acts chapter 2, verse 4, all of a sudden the Holy Spirit comes upon people and he starts speaking in tongues. And guess what? There is nations gathered all around in the city and they begin to hear the wonders of God, the goodness of God, the glory of God in their own language. And that's what the power is about. The power is about us seeing the gospel, us experiencing the gospel going forth in power, demonstrating, changing everything around us. So what good is a driver's license if we never get in a car? And we have this power. This is available to us. Let's use it. Let's tap into it. Let's press into it. Man, this power that we have in Christ, this authority that he's given us, is for our everyday life in Jesus.
Amen.
This doesn't just have to happen in the sanctuary. I mean, if you were at a funeral, I remember when this message was first spoken, I was a college student in southern Missouri, and the man that spoke this message, he said this line right here, I'm about to repeat. He said, if you're at a funeral, and God says to go lay your hands on the casket, would you be willing to be obedient? Or do we justify our disobedience?
Yeah.
Well, he doesn't even have any organs in him. He's already been. He doesn't have any organs. This is going to be awkward. Everybody's mourning God. What was it going to look like if God started moving us in faith and we just start laying hands on dead people? It was an interesting moment. I pray God does something like this. So 3 days after I heard this message, part of this message. The man who spoke the message passed away. He was on a motorcycle accident and he crashed. And the chaplaincy, I don't know what it's like to be in leadership when, I don't know what it's like to be in leadership when a group of people have this much faith that 3 days after he spoke this message, all of our CBC students wanted to show up at the funeral and pray over his casket. And they had to hold a special meeting just to stop us as students from showing up and overtaking his funeral. Because after we had heard that, yes, we have this power, that, yes, we can go and lay hands on the sick, all of a sudden there's people going to Walmart trips and all over the city, just like laying hands on people. We're moving this, and the senior leadership of the school had to say, hey, guys, let's be respectful. We know he just spoke this. We know we guys are so full of faith. So I'm looking, like the pastor said, this is all this dancing and little things right here. It isn't even close to the edge. Like I believe right now, we as a church, we aren't even close to the point of saying, hey, all right, guys, let's be mindful and let's learn how to do this appropriately. Right now, we're just hoping you guys just start stepping out in faith and saying, yes, I believe this. Yes, my paradigm is shifting. I'm going to start doing this stuff. So right now, the encouragement is just go do it, all right? But at that moment, in that case, they said, all right, guys, maybe we'll have a few guys can go in the back and we can have you pray over the casket, but let's let them do the funeral, do it in the morning. I believe the scripture. Jesus declared to me, Jesus declares to us this morning, Jesus declares to you, go, preach the gospel, preach the kingdom, lay your hands on the sick, they'll be healed, cast out some demons, raise them to life. Freely you've received, again, that's the key, freely you've received this power. Freely you've received this freedom, give it away. Give it away. What is it going to look like, guys? It's going to be exciting. Come together on Sunday morning and say, man, do you know what happened this week? Taking this a little bit further, talk about healing, but talk about ourselves. Sometimes we sit in our own sins instead of going after the freedom God has for us. John 8:32, he says that you will know the truth and the truth will set you free. But sometimes we get convinced that, oh, it's been a little bit of, I'm still dealing with this issue. I must not be free. This must not be working for me. And we begin to change our paradigm to think, oh, I can just sit in my sin. I can just deal with this bad habit. And it's okay because I haven't gotten freedom yet and God just must not have it for me. Instead of us thinking, no, God said that there is freedom to be had, I'm going to go after it. I'm going to chase after it. If there's something that He wants for me, I want that.
Yes.
You know, some of our computer programmers, I get to help people out with tech, but I'm nowhere near a computer programmer or engineer or knowing how to do things. But sometimes we get really mad at the computer. Anybody get really mad at the computer or the cell phone because it's not working the right way? Like, goodness gracious, why doesn't it just work? And sometimes it's not the computer, it's not the phone, it's actually us. It's kind of the same thing here. Jesus said there's freedom, it's the truth. And sometimes we aren't receiving what He has for us. It's not because there's something wrong with Him. It's not because the power has somehow lessened. It's not because the truth has somehow changed. Sometimes the problem is with us. Romans 8, verse 11. The same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead is now living in you. Why?